Hey everyone, I'm Dom.
And I'm Lewis.
And we are here to stack up the Xiaomi Pad 5 against Apple's new and updated 2021 iPad. That's the iPad. Not the iPad mini or the iPad Pro or the iPad Air, but the actual just plain old iPad, the entry level one. Because the Xiaomi Pad 5 sits around the same price. It's in the sort of 300 to 400 range. And it's one of those rare Android tablets I actually think might hold its own against an iPad in a head-to-head. So we wanted to find out. Okay, so Lewis is the tech advisor advocate for all things Apple, I think it's fair to say. The iPad launched this year alongside new iPhones, Apple Watch, and the new iPad mini. The iPad was in a way the sort of redheaded stepchild of that launch.
Oh,
it's the first thing they announced, but it's also the thing that got the fewest updates this year. So we thought what we're going to do is we're going to run through each of those new features in this year's iPad to kind of see how Xiaomi stacks up against the areas Apple felt it needed to optimize itself.
Yeah.
So what was the first big change in this iPad?
So let's start off with the strongest new point, I think I would argue it is anyway. So that's the 12 megapixel ultra-wide front-facing camera.
Of course, you started with the one thing I'm going to lose on.
All right, let's start off strong. All right, so yeah, we've got the 12 megapixel ultra-wide front-facing camera, which by itself might not sound that exciting, but it has Apple's center stage tech, which in itself isn't new, but it was previously exclusive to the iPad Pro, and now it's kind of trickling its way down. The iPad Mini has it, and now the entry-level iPad has it. I imagine the iPad Air will probably get it next.
So what is center stage?
So center stage is, it uses artificial intelligence to automatically crop in on you while you're on FaceTime and stuff like that. So that gives you the ability to put the iPad on a desk and then kind of move around the room a little bit more so you've got a bit more freedom. So not so much for standard FaceTimes, but if you're doing any tutorials or, you know, showing someone else to do something, it's so much easier to just plonk the iPad down, walk around the room and not have to worry about moving the iPad wherever you are.
But also even for standard FaceTime stuff, if say you're in a family household, if you're doing a FaceTime, but then someone else in the family walks into the room, it will kind of zoom out effectively to include them in the call as well.
Yeah, so I've been testing this a little bit and it is really responsive. So, because obviously it's not new tech, it was on the Facebook portal for some time.
Yeah.
But on the portal, it's a little bit slower to react than the Apple's that I've found in testing. And yeah, the pulling out is really nice as well.
Cool. So yeah, the Xiaomi does not do that, I'll be blunt. It doesn't have center stage and it doesn't really have anything software-wise that can match it. It is also going to lose on the camera spec. There is a front-facing camera here, but it is only an 8-megapixel number and it's not ultra-wide. It's an okay front-facing camera. Xiaomi has also included a rear camera, which is 13 megapixels and a bit better, but that still feels odd to me. It feels a bit weird. I think the best camera for a tablet needs to be the front-facing one. It's the one you're going to use for video calls.
Yeah.
Very few people are actually going to go do the weird tablet tourist thing and take photos with the big rear camera. So I do have to hand it to Apple on that one. If your main priority was video calling, base iPad does win.
It does. It is very nice. And yeah, so they took the same idea and they were like, let's not worry about the rear facing camera. It's the same 8 meg that's been on there for as long as I can remember at this point.
So they're almost an inverse. This is 8 on the front, 13 on the back. That's 8 on the back, 12 on the front.
It is, yeah.
And I mean, there's obviously other factors going to quality, aperture, and all sorts of other little bits and pieces, but I think in general, the iPad gets this. Okay, what's the second big change? Give me something I can win.
Okay. Let's go. Okay, let's talk about display.
Yeah.
Not a lot going
on
here.
Let's talk about display.
Not a lot going on here. So as you can see, it's the same 10.2-inch design as we've had for a couple of years now.
Uh-huh.
It's still got that chunky forehead and that chin that's still there. And it looks a bit dated, let's be real, compared to the rest of the iPad range and that
compared to this, which has an 11-inch display. You'll note this is actually basically the same size as the iPad. They are almost identical overall size, shape, weight, etc. But this has an 11-inch display, it's much bigger. It's got much thinner bezels all the way around, basically just enough that you can hold it comfortably, but otherwise the screen is getting towards edge to edge.
It is, yeah.
This has one other big display advantage. It is a 120Hz refresh rate display.
Yeah, can't compete with that.
Yeah, so this is gonna have that super fast refresh rate, really smooth animations across the board. It's only LCD, it's not OLED or anything like that, which makes sense for the price, but it's gonna be a fast, smooth display, especially good if you wanted to do any gaming on it.
Yeah.
But in general, just using the tablet around it feels really nice having that fast refresh rate. And with a tablet battery, you can handle it without worrying that it's gonna drain it too fast.
So I will say there is one change on the display front. I might as well point it out. It's a crazy, huge upgrade. Mm-hmm. You now have True Tone support on the entry-level iPad.
Yes.
Yeah, so the whites tweak based on the light of the room that you're in. Very exciting stuff. Yeah, no.
And this will do something pretty similar anyway, to be honest. I don't know if it's as good as Apple's True Tone, to be fair. True Tone is very good at what it does.
It is, yeah.
But yeah, display-wise, I think Xiaomi is the clear winner. It is bigger, it is smoother. It just looks an awful lot nicer from the front.
It
and
does.
If you're buying a tablet primarily as a either for gaming or like media consumption, you want to watch Netflix or Disney Plus, this is going to win hands down.
Oh, 100%.
All right, number three.
Number three, chipset. So what we're rocking this year is the A13 Bionic, which was the same as the iPhone 11.
Yep.
So a couple of years old, but not as bad as the entry-level iPad once was, because it was at one point rocking a chip that was 3-4 years old. So they boosted it up a little bit while keeping that entry-level price, which I appreciate.
Yep. This is probably going to be a bit of a draw, to be honest. This is powered by the Snapdragon 860. That is, this gets a little complicated. That is a refresh of the Snapdragon 855. The 855 is the two-year-old Qualcomm Snapdragon chipset. It's actually almost 3 years old because we're getting close to the refresh on that, but it's an updated one. So they're in the same kind of spot. They both got what was flagship hardware 2 or 3 years ago. I think performance-wise, we haven't actually benchmarked them side by side, but I think they're going to be very similar. Probably the iPad will edge it a little bit, because year on year, the iPads tend to, the Apple silicon tended to be a little nippier than Qualcomm's, but there's not a lot in it. Both of these will game comfortably, though not like blistering speeds.
Yeah, well, you're not hitting 120 hertz on
No, that's the one thing. On with 120 hertz for gaming, you will have to be a bit picky in which games can do that with an 860 in here. But still, they'll be capable of decent speeds. They're going to be very comparable for just moving around the OS, that sort of thing. I don't think there's a clear winner here.
No, I think you're all right on both sides there.
All right, what is the fourth and final thing Apple updated?
The fourth and final thing, hold on to your socks, guys, because this is a huge one. 64 gig of storage on the entry level. Oh yeah,
so that is
crazy amounts. No, so
you can actually fit the whole OS on it now, and one or two photos.
Imagine that.
Yeah,
because that was the big complaint with all the entry level iPads for years has been the entry level storage. First it was 16, and then it was 32. And while Android alternatives were kind of moving on from 32, Apple were like, nope, this is fine for the entry level. No one else agreed, but Apple thought it was the case. So yeah, they've finally given up the shit at 64 gig on the entry level, and then it goes all the way up to a 256 gig. No in between.
Yeah, that's the one thing I find odd. I think 64 is actually an okay start point, but I wish there was 128 model. Funny enough, this starts at 128 gig.
Imagine that.
Yeah, there are two models of this, 128 or 256, so it does vary, but by market here in the UK at least, there's actually only the 128 gig model on sale. But that is a lot more base storage. You are out of the gate going to be able to download an awful lot more Netflix to watch offline and that sort of thing. Even so, I think 64 is okay.
Yeah.
I don't think that's a big problem for a starting storage.
No.
And it's worth mentioning, there is a big difference in price here. Well, not a big difference, but there's a bit of a difference, which kind of affects this base storage question. The Xiaomi Pad 5 is £369 and the same in euros. There's not really an official dollar price because it's not launching in the US.
So for the iPad, it starts at 319 in the UK. So that's £10 cheaper than it was last year. But it's the same $329 in the US for the 64 gig.
So there is a £50 price difference going by the UK. So you can kind of convert that to your currency and think about it in that way. Given that this has double the base storage, in a way, it's sort of like, if you imagine how they might have priced the fictional 128 gig iPad, they're probably about the same.
Yeah.
So it kind of evens out a little bit on that. You do get more base storage here, but you are going to have to pay for it. Whereas if you know you don't need a lot of storage, the fact that there's a cheaper option is quite welcome there.
Yeah,
I think.
I'll take because I think most people that will get this iPad have never had an iPad before. They've never really had a tablet before, so it's going to take them time to fill up 64 gig worth of apps and games that they're going to have to discover on the App Store. Whereas someone like us, we wouldn't be happy with 64 because I could fill it up in a day.
Yeah. Worth running through a few of the other bits and pieces that I think the Xiaomi Pad 5 offers that not necessarily the iPad doesn't, but that aren't reflected by what Apple's chosen to tweak this year. I think the big obvious one, we touched on it already, but it is design.
Yes.
Apple has updated the iPad mini design this year. You might spot one lurking on the edge of the screen here. But the base iPad has stuck with the tried and tested big bezels and curved edges and all of that.
That Touch ID sensor at the bottom.
And the big Touch ID sensor. The Xiaomi Pad 5, actually, funnily enough, I hope this isn't unfair to Xiaomi to say, it looks quite a lot like the iPad Pro and the updated iPad Air and the iPad Mini. It's got the squared off edges and sides that make it feel a lot like Apple's premium tablets.
It does, yeah.
In a way that they haven't managed to get that design language onto their cheap model.
Yeah, it's, I mean, it's a shame, really, because that's the only thing that's really holding this back now.
Yeah.
You know, I they've upgraded the hardware, they've upgraded most aspects of it, but when you look, I mean, when you look at that front, you're like, that's an old tablet in this day and age compared to the rest of the iPad range. And yeah, like the competitors as well. That is a very good looking tablet. Mm-hmm. I think based on design only, that's the one I go for.
Yeah. And there is one other edge that the Xiaomi has over the iPad, which is a common one for Android-Apple debates, charging speeds. This isn't crazy, crazy fast, but it has 33-watt fast charging. And just as importantly, it's over a USB-C port.
Nice.
Whereas...
So, yeah, we are still on Lightning on the iPad. This is the last iPad with Lightning. Yeah. Still, you're still
Even Apple admits the Lightning is nearing obsolescence.
Yeah, so when they announced the iPad Mini, they said that the USB-C on the iPad Mini is 10 times faster than the Lightning.
Yeah.
So I was like, well,
so,
why
so
is it still
the Lightning still on that one?
And on your premium smartphone range. But anyway.
Set that aside.
So yeah, so it's Lightning max at 20 watts. So, you know.
It's not too bad,
it's
actually,
not
on speeds.
Not too bad, but it's not going to beat that anytime soon.
This will win on charging speeds and on data transfer stuff, and just, depending on what hardware you use, potentially convenience, because if you're otherwise on USB-C gear, it's the same charger.
Yes.
Equally, if you're carrying around an iPhone anyway, you might have a Lightning cable with you all the time, so that will even out a bit, depending on what you're using. And kind of inevitably, this is always the case with debates like this, that's also what ends up boiling down a lot to the recommendations.
It does.
Because as much as I'm singing the praises of the Xiaomi Pad 5, and I have to say I do really, really like this tablet, if you're an iPhone user and a Mac owner and all of that, you should probably still buy that one.
Yeah.
I mean, it's got the software edge as well. iPadOS is really, really, really good.
It is.
And it still remains unbeaten. And especially if you're used to an iPhone, you're obviously going to find it super familiar. You're going to have compatibility. Everything you do is going to sync smoothly and easily. That Lightning port won't bother you because you're already using Lightning on your phone. That kind of thing.
And the good thing is as well, they update them for years.
Yeah.
Like Apple is very good with their yearly software updates. So
that is true.
iPadOS 15, the iPad Air 2 got that, and that was from 2014, I think it was. So that's pretty impressive. What about?
Xiaomi hasn't made a commitment to software updates for the Pad 5, as far as I'm aware. I think it would be reasonable to expect one or two Android version updates, maybe three if you get lucky. I wouldn't feel confident predicting any more than that.
No.
So yeah, that is a win for the iPad software in general. I like the software here. MIUI is pretty good. It's not my favorite Android skin, but it's not bad. I do think they've done a good job of adapting it for the tablet form factor. Part of that is admittedly by borrowing things that Apple came up with on its iPads, like
weird.
A control center from the top right. Apple may have done that first. I'm not going to go so far to say Xiaomi did it better, but Xiaomi also did it. but the software is pretty solid here. I don't think you should worry about it too much. Android tablets have had a rough old time for the past few years. This is beginning to feel like a mature way to use a tablet. So yeah, if you're an Android user or a Windows user, you should look at this. I think for a long time, Android tablets have been recommended against, with the exception of a couple of the Samsung Galaxy tabs, but generally, especially at this price point, you wouldn't really buy one, you'd just buy an iPad. And the Android space was either you go premium with Samsung or you buy one of the really cheap Amazon Fire tablets if all you want is a small screen to entertain your kids. This feels like a mid-range tablet I would really happily recommend people buy. The screen is beautiful, the design is lovely. It's a real joy to use from a hardware perspective, and Xiaomi has knocked it out of the park there. But if you're already in the Apple camp, there's not quite enough here to pull someone over,
no,
I think.
Yeah.
It's almost there, but it's not.
Because this is the thing, where I'm an iPhone user and all that kind of stuff, I would never get an Android tablet because I need access to iMessage, I need access to FaceTime, I need access to all the apps I've spent years buying on the App Store. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to rebuy them on Android. And, you know, we laugh at the design and stuff like that, but I think for £319, this is still a pretty good tablet experience. You know, it's not the latest and greatest, but it will get the majority of people, they'll get the people who it's aimed at by.
Yeah.
Like, they will have no complaints from this whatsoever.
Absolutely. Still, I want to celebrate Xiaomi actually putting out an Android tablet that is a worthy rival.
Oh, yeah.
That I think for non-iPhone users, you should really, really, really strongly consider this if you're at that kind of price point, and that hasn't been the case for a long time. And I really hope this is the first sign of a regrowth in the Android tablet market. We're beginning to see it, and I want some real rivalry here. I want some alternatives to iPads because I want to force Apple to stop putting out ones that look like that.
The dream. The dream.
All right, thank you for watching. Remember to like and subscribe and check out more from Tech Advisor in the weeks and months ahead, especially as we go through the end of the big 2021 launch season. Thanks very much. Bye.
Bye.